Matthew Parish Church in Bailiwook. The service will take the form of morning prayer. We will begin service on page 35 in your book of common prayer. Blessed be the Lord our God.
By whose grace we are yet alive.
Blessed be his Son Jesus Christ.
By whose rising we are set free.
Blessed be the Spirit of God.
In whom is our hope and our joy.
Page 36. Say together. Father, we come together in the name of our Son Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, to offer you our worship, praise, and thanksgiving. To you belong all power and you are the source of all goodness. Let our worship be a witness to your peace and saving power. Through your Spirit, may we ever rejoice in the abiding presence of our risen and ascended Lord. Amen. Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. So let us celebrate the feast, not with the old leaven of corruption and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Christ, once raised from the dead, dies no more. Death has no more dominion over him. In dying, he died to sin once for all. In living, he lives to God. See yourselves, therefore, as dead to sin, and alive to God in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Christ has been raised from the dead, first fruits of those who sleep. For as by man came death, by man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Lord, we pray to you for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so hold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep in life eternal, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Psalms 23, found on page 495. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me to lie in green pastures.
And leads me beside still waters.
He restored my soul.
And guides me along right pathways for his name's sake.
Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil.
For you are with me, your rod and your staff.
You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me.
You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup is running over.
Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
And I will dwell in the house of the Lord.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen.
First lesson. Dawn of the high shall break upon us, to shine upon those who dwell in darkness, and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of all sea. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit,
as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be ever.
Every knee shall bow, and every tongue
and the sheep hear his voice. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. How often we have come to you, O Lord, to hear a word of comfort from you. Sometimes we are distracted, thinking about the things we have to do, the place we have to go to, the people we have to meet. But today, you have our undivided attention, because we've come to hear your still small voice speaking to us. So we say, come, Lord Jesus, come and speak to us while we're waiting, yielded and still. The image of the shepherd and the sheep is central to the things that we do as Christians in the church and in our daily lives. I recently watched a film on television a couple days ago about King David, the shepherd boy, as he was called. And it was amazing, it was fascinating actually, the way he spent quality time with the sheep, guiding them and leading them, and when one went astray, he would actually gently bring that sheep back into the sheepfold. And it was just amazing looking at the compassion and the tenderness that he gave to the sheep, and how responsive they were when they heard his voice calling them. And in the same way, Jesus actually tenderly and compassionately look after us, his sheep. And when we go astray, he too try to bring us back into the sheepfold. In the Christmas story, we learn that the shepherds were keeping watch over their flocks by night when an angel of the Lord appeared to them. What such good news. Shepherds have a huge part to play in the Christmas story that we tell about God who has come to us in Jesus Christ. We sing about them, we talk about them, we think about them, we write about them. Indeed, Jesus chose that title for himself when he said, I am the Good Shepherd. If Jesus is the Good Shepherd, then who are we? We are the sheep of his pasture. And our perception of sheep is that they are untidy, lazy, sometimes unruly animals who are just really just good for slaughtering and to be shaved, to make wool, etc. So I guess that the question that we should be asking is, who needs a shepherd? And this is a really challenging question, I think, for all of us that we need to think about. Contrary to popular belief, sheep are very intelligent animals. Sheep prefer to be led, and you can push cows, for example, but sheep will not go anywhere if someone does not go in front of them and lead them. They need a shepherd who will go ahead of them to show them that things are all right and that the way is clear and that they'll be safe and cared for. And so Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. My sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me. There is a bond that exists between the sheep and the shepherd, and the relationship grows, and the sheep and the shepherd develop a way of communicating that outsiders are not privy to. A good shepherd learns to sense and hear the bleat of one of the sheep of his flock when that sheep is in danger. And it's comforting, isn't it, to hear a familiar voice, especially when you're feeling down or things are not too good or you're lost and you want to find your way. It's so comforting to hear a familiar voice. A school friend of mine many, many years back called me yesterday to check upon me because obviously this is what's happening around the world at the moment. And she said, you've been on my mind, and I'd lost your telephone number, and I found it as I was clearing up some paperwork that had been there for a long time. And she said, it's nearly 10 years that we haven't actually spoken to each other. But it didn't seem that long to me. And at the other end of the phone, we still recognized each other's voice. We were giggling and we were laughing, we were joking, we were saying things like, gosh, you haven't changed, have you? You're still the same. You still have the same giggle, the same laugh. And in the same way, when Jesus calls us, we recognize his voice and we follow him. And we understand what he's saying to us, because we know where we're going is the same place, and we know who's actually leading us. I remember when I was a child, my friends and other siblings used to enjoy playing marbles, you know, marbles after school. Mom was always busy in the kitchen cooking, and my father, when he would come home from work, would gather us together. And if one of the children, one of my siblings, weren't actually there, we didn't actually respond positively or straight away, he would shout out her name. And if your name was called and you didn't walk swiftly and run and go straight away, my goodness, it wasn't good. He only called you once, and once was enough. And when he called, you recognize that sternness, that authority in his voice, and you respond immediately because you know what would happen if you didn't. And the rest is history. So we as children recognize the sternness and the authority of my father's voice. And we know that if he called you once, hey, you better look out. He's not going to call you two or three times again. And in the same way, when Jesus calls us, we should not ponder or hesitate or go in our own different ways. But we should run to him. We should be prompt and obedient, because we know that as his children, he would not call us to harm or danger. Because he said in his word that his plan for us is good and is to give us a hope and a future. Jesus, the Good Shepherd, leads us into the future. At the moment, things are very, very topsy-turvy. They're upside down. There's a lot of uncertainty and despair. And we know that certain things have happened beyond our control. But over and over again, the word of the shepherd for us has been, my peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither should it be afraid. But you know, in a time like this, where many, many people are afraid, where many, many people are anxious, where many people's hearts are troubled, where many people are waking up during the night time, lacking sleep because they're worried about what tomorrow may bring, and what's going to happen to them, what the next day is going to bring, and so forth. Of course your heart must be troubled. But we know that the word of God tells us that Jesus is the Good Shepherd. This is a word of the Good Shepherd for God's flock, for you, that he will give us his peace, even in times of turmoil, in times of being troubled, and in times of being uncertain, that he will come with his great arms of love and compassion and offer us his peace. This time has been tough for all of us, not just here in St. Vincent, but throughout the world. And can't say it's just happening here, and it's not happening in America, it's happening everywhere. People are crying, people are grieving, people are mourning their loss, people are uncertain, people are jobless, some have got to the point where food has become quite scarce in their home and so on. So it's not really a good picture to give out, but we know that it's reality that we're facing, and we know these things are happening right here. And some of us may feel very hopeless. Hopeless in the sense that there's nothing that I can do, it's all out of my hands. Well, I guess it is, in the sense that we can't stop this uncertainty or virus from spreading. We haven't found a cure, and at the moment we can't really say that it's going to stop tomorrow. But the Good Shepherd is reassuring us that there is hope. There is hope in him, there's hope in Jesus Christ. The good shepherd who so willingly laid down his life for his sheep. He is here with us, and we need to listen to his voice, his still voice, but his still small voice, as we continue to journey with God, the journey God has in store for you and me. And we will get through it. He will bring us through, because he said in his word, he'll never leave us or forsake us. And we know that God is here with us, irrespective of what we're experiencing. And so we journey with the assurance that we're not traveling alone, acknowledging that, as the Bible says, weeping may endure for the night, but joy will come in the morning. And so, in all that we say and do, we are encouraged to lean on the promises of the Good Shepherd, the promises of his everlasting arms, knowing that he is there to uphold us and to guide us and to comfort us. And so, this will involve us listening to his still small voice. And I know that we all need a shepherd to lead us, just like the sheep need to be led, and they would not go unless someone is in front of them, leading them and guiding them. Unless they have that reassurance that it's clear, everything is okay, and I will not be hurt, I will not be harmed. In the same way, we need to rely on the good shepherd and his promises for us. And the good news is that he's actually here with us. He's the one who has been sacrificially given to us. And I pray that we will not ponder and just wander away, but we will come closer during this time, hearing the still small voice of the shepherd, the one who's watching over us, the one who has our best interest at heart, the one who showered us immensely with his sacrificial love and care. So, we need to hold on to that as a promise that he will never leave us or forsake us. But let's go back to the question that I asked earlier. Who needs a shepherd? Well, all of us need a shepherd, as I said, to lead and guide us through this pandemic into the future. And I think when everything is over, I'm not God, I may be wrong, that things will never be the same. Lots of things will be changed. And the good news is that Jesus, the shepherd, has been sacrificially given to us. And no matter how far we roam or we wander, he's willing to draw us back to himself, if only we would trust him and allow him to lead us and guide us. The voice of the shepherds brings hope. For his voice speaks of redemption. He delights in us and loves to see us turn from our sinful ways. And in the same way, as a medical doctor, when you go to a doctor, they want to know what's wrong with you. They diagnose your predicament or whatever, and they give you a diagnosis of whatever your illness is before issuing a prescription. In the same way, you know, God convicts us of our sin, and the shepherd brings us to a place of forgiveness and renewal in him. And many of us are familiar with the story of the conversion of the Apostle Paul, who was known as the Saul of Simon of Tarsus. His dramatic experience on the road to Damascus is a demonstration of the powerful and transforming voice of the shepherd. As Saul set out to antagonize Christians, he met with God in his task. He fell to the earth and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" This is taken from Acts chapter 5, verses 9-4. So Saul's life was transformed after that dramatic encounter with God. And he later became known as Paul, so he became converted. And another person who heard the voice of the shepherd was a famous hymn writer, Horatius Hunter. And he wrote this wonderful hymn as a demonstration of his experience with an encounter with the good shepherd. I heard the voice of Jesus come to me and rest. Lay down thy weary one, lay down thy head upon my breast. I come to Jesus as I was, weary and worn and sad. I found him in a resting place, and he has made me glad. There is a sense that the voice of the shepherd is a calling to follow him. God calls us to believe in him and to trust him wholeheartedly. And he may be calling us to receive his salvation, power, and to follow him. But the scripture tells us, today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Psalm 95, verses 78. He may be calling you to a particular service or ministry or job, or he may simply want you to develop a closer relationship with him. In the book of Revelation, chapter 3, verse 20, he says, if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and dine with him and be, and I will come to him and dine with him and he'll be with me. The good thing is that he can speak to us individually or corporately, and we can still hear his voice. So as we read the Bible, as we read the Holy Scriptures, as we dwell in the Word of God, we find that the voice of the shepherd is revealed in his Word, the Bible. The Bible is God-breathed and divinely inspired. And in so doing, we can trust in his Word. Because the Bible is the written Word of God. All that Jesus spoke about was a revelation of God to man. God can speak to us through conversation, through a conscience, through his creation, through visions, through dreams, and so forth. But he specifically speaks through Jesus Christ and his Holy Scripture. So the voice of the shepherd is, in fact, the voice of his Heavenly Father. And in the same way that God's voice can hover over the waters, the God of glory thunders. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. In Psalm 29, verses 3 to 4. So too is the voice of Jesus Christ. So we read in the Bible about the depth of creativity of Jesus. And this is enshrined in particular ways and in his voice. For example, the loaves and the fishes, feeding of the 5,000. There was an abundance of food to feed everyone. Even at the beginning, people were wondering, how are we going to be fed? How is this big crowd going to be fed? And the voice of the shepherd also commands us to love our enemies, to pray for those who persecute us, to remain humble, to turn the other cheek. We're also convicted of sin through his voice and the Holy Spirit. And where there's pride, where there's malice, where there's hypocrisy, his desire is for us to humbly repent and trust in him, and trust also in his salvation. He came not to condemn us, but that we might be saved through him. So Jesus Christ calls us through his still small voice, come, follow me. His voice calms the torrent waters and brought tranquility and stillness and silence the demoniac who live among the tombs. So when we look also at the cross of Jesus Christ, we can begin to comprehend that we all need to be at the foot of the cross, that we all need a shepherd to guide us and lead us. And we all need to understand that forgiveness was purchased by Jesus Christ. We see that peace and redemption were purchased in Jesus at the cross. And this is to be remembered by Christians where we were, when we look at the scriptures and we dwell in the scriptures and understand, and also when we come to partake of the Holy Eucharist. We won't be doing this today, but when we do, it's a reminder to us as Christians, a because the cross has said it all. In the historical era, the voice of God is heard. Where are you? And the final message from God is, and I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. Revelations 20, verse 3. So in short, how can we listen to the voice of God? Well, there are many, many different ways, as I said. Bible, of course, reading and understanding the Word of God. Through our prayers, when we pray to God, we sometimes use the scripture to back up our prayers, but God can speak to us through a prayer as we come to him in humble adoration and put forward our supplications and the cries of our hearts. We can ask God through prayer to show us what he wants us to do. Through dreams and visions. I remember when I went on a mission to Uganda in West Africa, it was actually a dramatic experience that I encountered the Good Shepherd, I would say, because God spoke to me in an audible voice. And no one else could hear me, but I could. He made it clear to me that he wanted me to go into full-time ministry, something that I was running from for a long time, because I said I wanted to hear God speak to me, not knowing that he was going to speak to me in that hotel room as soon as I landed in Uganda on a mission trip. That was the first encounter I had with him. He can speak for us through natural means, through God's creation, such as the things around us. I love flowers. I love looking at the variety of flowers, you know, the shapes and the colorations, the sizes, the beauty, the perfume and the aroma that they give off and so on. And God can actually speak through them. I think he speaks to you through flowers, actually. Through trees, through everyday conversations, through ordinary means, through other people. Just like, he spoke to other people, prophets of the old and apostles and disciples in the Bible. He can also speak to us. God wants to direct us in every area of our lives. And I encourage you to listen to his voice and obey him, to read his word daily and to thank him for the leading and guiding you do have so far. The more you get to know him, the stronger your ability to hear his voice. And so, in short, listen attentively to what the shepherd might be saying to you, not just today, but at other times. His voice will meet you at your point of need, and by bringing you closer to him, you will be able to understand clearly what he's saying to you, to make you a blessing to others who are yearning to hear his voice. And today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Listen. Trust him and obey him. So let us pray. Lord, help us to hear your specific instructions. Speak to us clearly through your words so that we will know what's right and what's wrong. Help us to be ever learning about your ways so that we can live in the fullness of your presence and more into all you have for us. Help us to be obedient. As Samuel in the Bible says, speak, Lord, your servant hears. May we hear your still small voice speaking to us. If there are steps of obedience we need to take that we don't understand, Lord, I pray that you open our eyes to see the truth and help us to take these steps. So I pray that you would enable us to live in obedience to your words this day and forever. In Jesus' name. to say the Apostles' Creed together.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life of the Lord.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and
save your people, Lord, and bless your inheritance.
Go and uphold them now and always.
Day by day we bless you.
We praise your name forever.
Lord, keep us from all sin today.
Have mercy on us, Lord. Have mercy.
Lord, show us your love and mercy.
For we put our trust in you.
In you, Lord, is our hope.
We shall never walk in vain.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Reading prayer for the fourth Sunday of Easter. O God, whose Son Jesus is the good shepherd of your people, grant that when we hear his voice, we may know him who calls us each by name, and follow where he leads, who Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Lord God, the love of unity and author of peace, to know you is eternal life, to serve you is perfect freedom. Defend us, your servants, from all assaults of the enemy, that we may trust in your defense and not fear the path of any adversity. For Jesus Christ, our Lord. God, who make us glad with the week of remembrance of the glorious resurrection of your Son, O Lord, give us this day such blessing through a worship of you, that the week to come may be spent in your favor, through Jesus Christ, O Lord.
Amen.
Now, as the prayers we found on page 76. Prayer for strength. May the strength of God pilot us. May the power of God preserve us. May the wisdom of God instruct us. May the hand of God protect us. May the way of God direct us. May the shield of God defend us. May the host of God guard us against the snares of evil and the temptations of the world. May Christ be with us. Christ before us. Christ in us. Christ over us. May your salvation, O Lord, be always ours this day and forevermore.
Amen. Eternal light, shine into our hearts. Eternal goodness, deliver us from evil. Eternal power, be our support. Eternal wisdom, scatter the darkness of our ignorance. Eternal pity, have mercy upon us, that with all our hearts and mind and soul and strength, we may seek your face, and with brought by your infinite mercy to your holy presence through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Pray for direction. Be with us, Lord, in all our prayers, and direct our way towards the attainment of salvation, that among the changes and chances of this mortal life, we may always be defended by your gracious help, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Grant protection. Almighty and eternal God, sanctify and govern our hearts and bodies in the ways of your laws and the words of your commands, that under your protection, now and ever, we may be preserved in body and soul, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
With guidance. Guide us, Lord, in all our doings with your gracious favor, and further us with your continual help, that in all our works begun, continued, and ended in you, we may glorify your holy name, and by your mercy attain everlasting life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Pray for peace among the nations. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, guide the nations of the world into the way of justice and truth, and establish among them that peace which is the fruit of righteousness, that they may become the kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
the Holy Spirit be with us evermore.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
End by singing a jolly hymn. 418. 418. And pressing on.
Thank you.
And have a wonderful day. Thank you for coming.